Jesus, I love you so, never wanna let you go. And all the love you have for me, Jesus, do you see what you need to be?
Hello, I'm Reverend Joseph, your host, and welcome to New Hope in the Lord. With me today is my co-host, Rosa Owens. Rosa, nice to see you.
Nice to see you, Reverend Joe.
We have a nice decoration of some beautiful flowers.
Yes, this is the day the Lord has made. We rejoice and be glad in it.
Yes, it's springtime.
It's springtime.
And springtime means new life.
New life, new rebirth.
So I want to open up and talk just a couple of minutes about new life that I received through the email, and I'm going to read it to the audience before you introduce our guests.
Okay? Praise God.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, that's what our program does. It brings new life. It brings you a life that you never knew without Christ. You would never know the life that you have with Christ, like our guest is going to speak to you about the new life she has. But I received this email yesterday, and I just want to read it to you. And by the way, our email address is on the screen, rev.joseph@aol.com. You can send us prayer requests. We'll pray for you. Enjoy our broadcast, let us know. You don't like our broadcast, let us know. we want to hear from you. You don't have a computer, we have our mailing address there, and we'd like to hear from you. So I want to read this to you, ladies and gentlemen. It says, this is Bettina. You had me on your program. I shared my testimony of being set free from mental illness. God can do anything, ladies and gentlemen. I don't care what your situation is, your circumstance today. God is God, and His name is Jesus. There's no other God except Him, and He can set you free from whatever bondage you might be in. And she was on the program last year in 2014 in August, she said. I just want to share with you that my Bible study group had a special meeting where they showed the DVD of my testimony. It was very powerful, and about 20 people came who were either mentally ill or had relatives that they stood in for that were mentally ill. And she went on to say, there's power in the testimony. Speaking about my life after I became born again brought many people new hope. And that's what this program is about, ladies and gentlemen, bringing new hope to the hopeless. So Bettina is a witness of God took a woman who was mentally ill, touched her, changed her, and she's serving the Lord now, bringing hope to others. You have an opportunity to receive Jesus through this program. Thy word is truth. This program is truth. The testimonies you hear are true. They're not fake. They're not like a reality show on TV where the people glorify their sin that they're in and get millions of dollars. But we just have ordinary people who had lives that are now extraordinary because of Jesus Christ. Rose, would you like to introduce our guest, please?
Definitely. I'm so happy to introduce Kay Brown to our program. Welcome, Kay.
Thank you for having me. It's really an honor and a privilege being here.
Praise God. So, Kay, can you share with us a little bit about yourself, your upbringing?
Absolutely. I was raised as a Jehovah's Witness, baptized as a Jehovah's Witness, one of the only kids in a family that really took it serious. From when I was a little girl, I felt that there was a God, and I felt that I wanted to have some type of relationship with Him. But as I got older and got into teenage, I kind of walked away from that a little bit. And I told my mother that I had a boyfriend, And when you're a witness, if you have a boyfriend, and I just didn't have a boyfriend, if I can be honest, I was also fornicating. And you get disfellowshipped from the organization if you do that. So I put the pressure on my mom. So she went and told the elders. And of course, I was disfellowshipped from being a Jehovah Witness. I kind of put some roof in the family. You know, certain family members didn't want to be around me, wouldn't talk to me. People wouldn't go to functions if I was there. And I just kind of got into the world and got involved in a lot of different things, the club scene, drinking. But there was still something where I could not go over the edge. You know, for some reason, I couldn't go all the way in. And I understand now that that was God in my life. Yes.
He was watching over you.
Absolutely.
So you couldn't push over the edge.
Absolutely.
So how do you, what happened? How did you fill that void?
Well, you know, I did well in school. I got married, got my bachelor's as a nurse, but I still walked around feeling like something was missing and something was empty from my life, even though it seems like everything else on the outside was good. I had twin girls, you know, living a good life, self-sufficient. But it got to the point where I started having these suicidal thoughts. Every time I would get in the car, there would be a voice that would tell me to just slam the car into a brick wall or any wall. And the voice would tell me that I wouldn't die. Just go ahead and do it. And
the lies of the devil.
Yes, right? Absolutely. Absolutely. And I was plagued by that for quite some time. And I knew that I needed something different in my life. And I had two young ladies that, let me say this, you don't have to always knock people in the head about Christ. You just have to live Christ.
That's
and
right.
Love people. And though they never invited me to church, they loved me and they were different.
You know, Kay, religion is such a deterrent from people receiving Christ.
Absolutely.
You're the first Jehovah's Witness that we've had on, ex-Jehovah's Witness.
Yes.
We've had Muslims on. Mm-hmm. I'm Jewish. Uh-huh. We've had a lot of Jewish people on. We've had a Hindu person on. And we had Catholics, and we've had Protestants on who all had this religion.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that religion does is they kind of make you a slave, mass task slave person to their rules and their regulations. And what you said so beautiful just now was that she didn't preach to you about Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
She showed you the love of Jesus through you.
Yes.
As opposed to the Jehovah's Witness, it was because you didn't do everything in column A.
That's right.
We're going to separate you. And the Bible says nothing shall separate you from the love of God.
Absolutely.
In Christ Jesus. And that's what religion is.
Yeah.
It's a bunch of rules and regulations and traditions that turn people off to God. And if you don't do it my way. But thank God, you know, Rosa, that the Lord says in his word that I forgive you.
Amen.
And that,
amen.
That's what Easter is all about.
He died on that cross for the sinners. So once we're forgiven, nobody could separate us from him.
And he rose from the dead.
Amen.
And that's the new life that we have in Christ. So
the Holy Spirit is in us.
So this young lady was just loving you. And did you think it was kind of a little weird that she was loving you without telling you about Jesus?
No. I wanted what she had. I wanted to know why she seemed so free and why she loved me in spite of who I was. And I wanted that light that I saw in her. Mm. So she lived a life and treated me in a way that I hadn't been treated because all I knew was religion. Do this, don't do that. Mm. And I walked around every day in condemnation. And that's a religious spirit.
Because you could not fulfill what they wanted.
Absolutely.
And the reason why you couldn't fulfill it, because you're a human.
Mm-hmm.
And we have our flesh that sins. And the only one that could fulfill it was that perfect one, and his name is Jesus.
Amen.
Absolutely.
Amen.
And I will say, I did a lot of searching for God because I knew he was there. But I didn't understand truly that Jesus was the way, the truth, and the life. And I got involved. I studied with Muslims.
Studied with the Muslims.
I studied with Mormons.
The Mormons.
I studied with the radical black Israelites, as they identify themselves. And I also, for a period of time, became a Rastafarian. And had even denounced God and claimed that Haile Selassie, who was a man, who was also a Christian, that he was God. I was lost in my search for God, but God never lost a hold of me. And he led me to him through the light and love of somebody else.
So what happened? Can you tell us about what happened when you went to this church?
Going to church was a scary thing for me because being raised as a witness, I was told that you should never go to church. Every other religion outside of being a Jehovah's Witness was false, and they were demonic, and there was no such thing as the Holy Spirit in the way that I understand him today as a person. And, you know, if you go there, it's going to be a bad thing. And I went, and I didn't understand anything that was going on, and I didn't understand why they constantly called on the name of Jesus.
Wait. Well, hold it. Now, back up. You didn't understand why people who proclaim to be Christians, right, and the whole faith is Jesus.
Absolutely.
That's it.
Yes.
Nobody else.
Yes.
He is God who died for our sins. And here you were in them, brainwashed with the theology of Jesus not being God. And yet you didn't understand the whole thing.
I didn't understand it.
I mean, this is insane.
Yes.
This is crazy. And that I wonder, before Jehovah's Witness got founded, for all those thousands of years.
Yes.
So that means that everybody was wrong until Jehovah's Witness started.
Well, those are the questions that started to plague my mind. They have an answer for that. And the answer was that everybody who lived before them, they're going to get a chance during the resurrection that the witnesses are going to preach to them.
And that's totally unscriptural.
It is not scriptural. Yeah,
it's man-made stuff that have. See, the devil has an answer for everything. You know,
he's
like
a counterfeit.
Like he said, well, just go drive your car into the wall and you're not going to die. Well,
yes.
Well, how does he know you're not going to die?
Yeah.
But God had his hand upon you.
And I'm so grateful.
And you see, you found out that, religion cannot change your heart. Religion did not change this woman Bettina's heart and take away
the
mental illness, but the Word of God did. You know, and so so now you're in this church that's crazy because they told you not to go to these crazy people.
That's correct.
And they probably acted crazy.
Yes.
Because you didn't understand what it meant to have Christ come into your heart. And so how was your time in the crazy place?
Well, I would keep telling myself I'm never going back there. But I heard God speak to me and he said to me, I know you don't get it. And I know you don't understand, but I just want you to sit here and I will explain everything to you. I will explain to you why they recognize Jesus as God. And he's done that for me and he's radically changed my life. And I am grateful. And in fact, I became the craziest acting person in the church. You know, something I said I would never do.
Oh, so in other words, don't ever say you'll never do.
That's right.
Because I remember after I first came to Christ many years ago, I said, I would never go to the prison there. I would never go and speak to these people there. They deserve what they get. I should say that's before I came to Christ. And lo and behold, about 3 years after I came to Christ, you know, God gave me a prison ministry for like 20 years. So you never say, I'm not going to do it. Was there one specific time, Kay, that you remember that you had that personal relationship where Jesus come into my heart and forgive me of my sins and did that, or was it just basically that you just flowed in the mix when you were there?
I do remember, and it did not happen in a church setting. It happened at home. So I started going to church and listened to the Word and began to be sanctified by the Word, but I still wasn't saved because I still couldn't see Jesus. And I remember I was at home and I said, God, I feel like there's a wall. What am I missing? And I remember opening the scriptures and reading them and realizing that Jesus is God and Jesus is the way,
amen,
you know, to God and to to salvation, and I received them in my living room on that day.
And what was the difference on your inside about how you felt? Did that void get filled?
Absolutely.
Did you have that peace that you never had?
Absolutely.
Did that condemnation go away?
Absolutely.
That's what Jesus does.
That's what he does. Okay. Yeah. I will say this, the enemy will try to come back, especially if you have some things embedded in you and try to put things in your mind. But Jesus is always there reminding me that in me you're free and I've given you a new life and a new hope, and you don't have to return to those things. You know, I had father issues and I brought that into my relationship with God, but he has been so patient with me and he's taught me to receive his love, and for that I am grateful.
So how did your family react when they found out you were in this Jesus thing?
They thought I was crazy and that I was just on another one of my seeking missions. I am almost 8 years in. My mother initially was very angry. She was very upset.
Now, excuse me. Was your family Jehovah's Witness too?
Predominantly, okay. A lot of my family are Jehovah's Witnesses. My dad, he wasn't anything at the time. He's since been saved at 72.
Oh, praise
something
God.
I prayed for, but I thought I would see it on his deathbed. I was actually there to witness him accept Jesus Christ. And he goes to a Baptist church.
Praise the Lord.
My mom came around. I mean, before she died, we were praying together, we were reading the scriptures together, and she believed, you know, being a Jehovah's Witness, she believed and understood that Jesus had done something in me. So she accepted it and she encouraged me.
She saw in you,
what you saw in the other people.
Yes.
So it's catching.
Yes.
You know, somebody once said, tell people about Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And if you need to, share the word.
Share the word, yeah.
So basically, it's let your light shine and make them jealous.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right? Yes. Absolutely. That's what happened to me. I was jealous and I wanted what they had. But, you know, sometimes we profess to people that once you're saved, your whole life is going to be perfect. And my life did not get perfect.
It's probably the opposite.
Yes.
It is absolutely
the
opposite.
What did you have before you came to Christ?
Well, I thought I had everything. Mm-hmm. But I had nothing.
You had material
things. I had material things. I had everything materially that I needed. I had friends. I had a great career, and I could support myself. You know, so there really was no need. But when I came to Christ, everything got pulled away from me. The husband who I thought made me feel complete, you know, the car, my apartment burned down. But even in the midst of that, there was this unspeakable joy.
Wait, hold it.
Wait,
listen, I know I'm getting old, but I don't think I need a hearing. Did you hear what she said?
Yeah, I heard what she said.
Repeat that again. When your apartment burned down.
My apartment, strange fire. To this day, I don't have time to go into the story. No one really understands how the apartment burned down, what the enemy meant for evil. God meant it for good.
So you're watching your apartment burn down and you have joy in your heart.
Joy in my heart. Singing and praising while it was happening.
And why is that? How could you praise God while that's going on?
I literally felt like he just sat in me and gave me this peace and this comfort that even in the midst of the storm, and we go through storms, he never said that it was going to be a bed of roses, but he did promise us that he would be there with us. He said, my peace, I leave with you. I give it to you, not as the world giveth. It's a different type of peace. It's a peace that you get in the midst of crazy stuff going on.
And so before you came to Christ, and you're looking at your apartment burned down, tell us what your reaction would have been.
I would have gone crazy. It's funny because at that time, my husband, ex-husband now, and I were separated, and I was a reactionist. I would get angry and I would lash out and I would curse everybody out every chance that I get. And his mom told me that he called her and said, Kay is okay. And if Kay is okay, everybody else is okay. So he was sensing that peace and that calm that God gave me as well.
Now, I want to ask you a question. Did you make the 911 call?
I did.
And
were you frantic?
How were you when you made that call?
If you listen to the phone call, this is how it sounded. Hi, my name is Kay. I live at such and such an address, and my apartment is on fire. I think you should come now. And you probably would think that I set the fire because I was so calm, you know, and I thank God for that. When I got off the elevator, I had stepped out for 15 minutes. Within the space of 15 minutes, just keep thinking that something was wrong at my kid's school and just being urged by what I understand now is the Holy Spirit. He guides and protects you to go across the street. You know, it was to save my life so that I wouldn't have been caught in the fire. And God was just amazing in that. To this day, they don't know what caused the fire. You know, and it did leave me homeless. It did leave me without everything. A couple months before that, I was without a car. Before the day I got baptized, my car blew up in the street, caught on fire, and I left it in the street. And my children and I went to get baptized. My husband at the time gave us a hard time, fought with us in front of the church, said, "Why are you doing this? And why are you doing this to our kids?" But he sat in the back of the church and he cried and he didn't know why he was crying. And I know that was Jesus Christ.
Cleansing of the Holy Spirit.
The cleansing, yes. Amen. Yes. And, you know, this show is New Hope in the Lord, and I have hope for him as well. I continue to pray. You never know what God is going to do.
Amen. God is always faithful.
Yes. He wants everybody to be saved and to know him.
Yes. And even being homeless with my children, I still had peace. And I still had joy. And that caused them to be settled. You know, because, you know, kids are, they trust their parents. And they feed off of you.
Yes.
And sometimes as parents, we don't pay attention to that. And we went to live with my brother, who lived in a little basement apartment. And we slept on the fourth floor for 2 years.
Wow.
And God promised that he would give us a home. I didn't ask for one. But this is what he said he wanted for me. He stripped me of everything I thought made me who I am, to show me who I am in him.
Amen.
And to show me that he had given me a new life and that I can rely on him and that he is not just my savior, but the Lord of my life. I had no credit. I had no money. But God said, "I'm going to give you a home." Every creditor, every bank, MCU, everybody turned me down. And at almost 2 years in, I said, "God, I can't do this to my kids anymore. People were telling me I have no ambition. Look how you're living." But God said, "No, I have this for you." And the Holy Spirit whispered to me and said, "A man named John is going to give you a loan." And 2 months later, a man named John called me. I, to this day, don't know where he got my information from, how he got my number. And he did help me to get a loan to get into a home. In fact, he paid for my appraisal and inspection twice. I never met him. I didn't meet him until the day of closing. But when God gives a promise, his promises to us are yes, and they are sure.
So God truly gave you favor.
Yes, he did.
Because his word says he encompasses his children with favor.
Absolutely.
Hallelujah.
Absolutely.
So here you have the Holy Spirit, who is God.
Yes.
And he's in you.
Yes.
Where the Jehovah's Witnesses says the Holy Spirit is an it.
It.
Instead of a person.
Right.
And he doesn't exist now.
Right.
And so here the Holy Spirit is speaking to your heart. You're hearing his voice about John, and it comes to pass.
And it comes to pass.
And the Holy Spirit led you not to go into the house.
Into the house, absolutely.
Because he, not an it, who
he
speaks, knew that the house was going to burn up.
Yeah.
And so basically what's happened is that God has shown himself faithful to you. He's shown himself real. And just briefly, you have a talk show yourself.
Yes, I do.
Why don't you tell us about it and give the some information. They'll probably have some on the screen, but why don't you just briefly tell about your show.
The show is called The Journey to the Cross and Beyond. What our mission is to help prospective believers, new believers, and even old seasoned saints to understand the love of God and the life that awaits every believer, which is very unique, beyond the point of salvation. We are very transparent. It's a journey. I'm growing. I'm growing in Christ every day. Things that I talk about last year, this year, he's given more revelation, you know, in that. So it's just a show that kind of goes along with you as you're journeying. We're a companion. We talk about the ups and the downs of this Christian life, and our duty is really to exhort our viewers and also to showcase the gifts and the talents that God has placed in this earth for his glory.
And they can find you on YouTube, is that right, Kay?
Yes, the YouTube channel, you can rewatch us, is The Journey TV, Kay Brown. You can watch us live every second and fourth Saturdays from 3 to 4 p.m. or 2 to 3 p.m. at www.thematrixstudiosnetwork.com. And I'm just grateful for it. This is our fourth year, and God is doing amazing things. It's a secular site. And we're privileged to be there because we want to reach people who do not know the love of Jesus Christ, who do not understand the person of Jesus Christ. And they love us there. A lot of times, you know, the people who record the show or even the people there, they tell us how grateful they are for the word that they've heard. And God is doing something even in that place. Amen.
And so now you have a home.
I have a home.
And could you describe your home for us?
I have 4 bedrooms, 3 bathrooms with a jacuzzi.
Wow.
A huge backyard in Austin, New York. Great school district. So God literally took me from the pit to the palace. And I'm not glorifying the material things. God knows how he wants to show himself mighty in our lives. But the greatest lesson that I've learned is that God is real. Jesus is God.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit is God and lives in us.
Amen.
And he will lead us in all truth. Amen. He'll never leave us and forsake us.
And,
amen.
And nobody would give you credit.
No.
But nobody except Jesus.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much, Kay, for your compelling testimony, for coming on the show today.
Thank you for having me.
Ladies and gentlemen, the choice is yours. Amen. Your sins are forgiven through the blood of Christ. And without receiving Jesus in your heart, your sins will never be forgiven and you can't get to heaven. After you die, then you'll be eternally damned and judged for your sins. Jesus paid for your sins. He paid for our sins. It's a free gift. Come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest.
Yes.
You can have peace, rest, and joy like Kay has, and your sins will be forgiven. And when you die, you'll be into heaven. Thank you for watching our broadcast today.
Amen.
Jesus, I love you so much.